Father, our God, we come to you tonight, Lord, because we realize that all power in heaven and earth is in your hands. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you, Father God, because we know that it's not about us, but everything that we do is all about you. We thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for this place, and we thank you for this opportunity to be able to come and to do what you would have us to do. We pray, Lord, that hearts are open, minds are better, spirits are revived. We pray that you remove every hindrance and barrier from preaching, and most of all, we pray that you get all of the honor, all of the glory, and all of the praise. All of these things we ask in Jesus' name. Christ, the one who we fear does all things well, and if he's not by now, he ought to be. The head of all of our life, to the pastor of this great church, to this wonderful friend and brother, Pastor Royster, we thank God for him. God bless him, and we thank God for his friendship. We thank God for these preachers tonight. God bless Reverend Hardy, who's here tonight. Thank God for Pastor Wilson, and thank God for all of the pastors and preachers who are gathered here tonight. We thank God for these officers tonight. And thank God for all of you who are here, mothers, missionaries, visitors, and friends. It's good to be here. God has blessed us to live to see this night, to live to see this night, where he didn't have to give us a chance to do it, because we did not earn the privilege. Grandmama said, on our way, we live in the land of the living. On our way to the land of the dying. Somebody used to say that, but I heard somebody turn it around and say, we in the land of the dying. Yes. On our way to the land of the living. Yes. We thank God tonight for his grace. We thank God tonight for his mercy. God bless this great church, and thank God for you and for your prayers and everything that you have done, and for this week. Amen. Lest I forget, we're thankful for that. God bless Zion Grove. It ain't but one. Zion Grove. I heard of a lot of Zion, but it ain't but one Zion Grove. And thank God for Zion Grove. God bless this choir tonight and these singers, and God bless this musician tonight. And when I looked at her, I'm reminded, my mind go way back. And I can remember when I was about that size. What y'all laughing at? And when my mama played the piano. And I used to sit with her. Now, he's sitting in your lap like he know you. So, and that reminded me of that. So thank God for her. Thank God for faithfulness. And thank God for, this is still revival, isn't it? And we've already discovered that the revival has a threefold purpose. The church be revived, and sinner be saved, backslider be reclaimed. We discovered that, and we discovered that the real revival ultimately starts with the church. Amen. And we thank God tonight for a such thing as revival, because all of us need it sometime. Amen. Sometimes you down, you deflated so low the pastor can't get you up. Amen. And you need to hear some preaching, because sometimes we need some preaching. Amen. And sometimes the pastor stands on Sunday morning trying to help folks, and he need help himself. Amen. And we thank God for revival. Amen. And in contemplating tonight, in trying to go a certain direction, and the Lord wouldn't let it happen. And I started to remember your theme, Acts 3, 19 and 20, which says, repent, return, and be revived. All right. And that particular theme reminds me of a story that's familiar to you, I'm sure. And if it's not, hopefully it will be by the time I get finished tonight. And I was trying not to go there, but that's where we're going. The Gospel according to Luke, chapter 15. Because the idea is for someone, and the grandmama sung the song, "Let Your Light Shine." Someone may be lost in the valley, trying to get home, and I don't know why, but I'm convinced tonight that there may be someone, you in the church, but you're still in the valley, and there needs to be there needs to be reconciliation. Luke chapter 15, two verses, verses 17 and 18. He said, are you ready?
Yeah.
17 says, and when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. And just for a few minutes, I just want to talk about, for a few minutes, I got home on my mind. Amen. Home. In the life of a believer, a believer's life usually starts when he or she has confessed faith and hope in Christ. Somewhere down the line, you had to say, yes, I want Jesus to be the head of my life. You made a commitment. You allowed him to become the head, and you allowed him to become the head and the chieftain of your life. And you said, I want my life to be governed by his ordinances, statutes, and to be led and guided by his Holy Spirit. That's a good thing. And if you're here tonight and you have not confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, is the best decision, I can attest to that, is the best decision you could have ever made. I really don't have to interview anybody in the house, even though I believe that somebody has made that decision, because I know from personal experience that I have made it for myself. But I also have learned from personal experience that ever since I made that decision or that declaration, I didn't do everything right. And somewhere down the line, something happened, and somewhere down the line, God placed in your spirit a spirit of repentance.
Yeah.
And repentance simply means that you turn around from the direction in which you were going.
Yeah.
And you decide to come back in the direction that God would have you to walk.
Yeah.
Now, somebody in the house tonight, and you don't have to raise your hand, but somebody in the house tonight knows something about repentance. You can't, listen, repenting simply means that I am wrong and I need to turn around. And but I want to let you know tonight, you need to thank God because he loved us enough to put repentance in the plan. Because God is so wise that none of our actions ultimately sneak up on him. So God knows essentially if that time comes and when it comes where you might step off of what he told you to do. And God put something in the plan to ensure that you would have a chance to come back home. My pastor, late pastor Dr. Marvin, used to say he compared it to a self-cleaning oven. He said when a man made a self-cleaning oven, he put a mechanism in the oven. And the mechanism is there for the purpose to clean the oven. Meaning that in the process of use, he knew ultimately that the oven would get dirty. And he put something in the plan with the ability to clean what might get dirty. Are y'all following me? So when it comes to that, and we apply it to this, that God is so good that even he knows that in the process of life, somewhere down the line, you may not get it all right, but he put something in the plan. So just in case you decide that you want to come back home, he gives us an avenue that we may be able to come back to him. I believe that there are people tonight that need to come back to God, but some people don't know how to come back. And I believe that there are people who need to come back and they don't really realize that God wants them, because too many times we put in people's mind that they done messed up so bad that God don't want them, the church don't want them. But I want to beg to differ tonight. The reason Jesus died is for sinners like us. Bible says in our text tonight that as we look at this 15th chapter, that some theologians have deemed it the lost chapter. Because as you read the chapter, you see various examples of something being lost. If you read it, you'll see about the lost sheep who wandered away. Not necessarily on purpose, but because the shepherd loved the sheep, went out and brought him back in physically, because he knows that without being in the fold, that ultimately the sheep would die. Yeah. Then he talks about the lost coin, where a lady somehow would have lost or misplaced her money, and she swept the whole house. And finally found it and rejoiced when she ultimately found her coin. But in the latter part of the chapter, he deals with a son and what we commonly refer to as the prodigal son. And here's a boy, the text says that there was a man that had two sons. And the youngest son came to his dad and said, "Father, give me the good. Give me my portion that falls unto me." In other words, give me my part of the inheritance. What I'm supposed to get after you die, I want mine now. Give me my portion. There's a couple of things wrong with that. The first thing that's wrong is that usually you don't get a part of an inheritance until after the daddy died. Are y'all following me? Usually you don't start cutting up stuff until after you dead. Y'all need to hear me tonight. And usually you don't start giving away your living until after you gone. Now you may write down who's supposed to get what. And that don't mean they're going to follow that. But I can't give you your part while I'm living, because I'm still living. And as long as I'm still living, all them parts are mine. My son can come to me tonight and say, "Daddy, I want my part." I'm going to tell him, "You ain't got no part yet." As long as I'm living, don't try to get your part till I'm dead. And you don't need it right now, because I'm not trying to go in the ground. I'm going to outlive you. So he says, I want my part. Not only that, he says, listen, another thing wrong with it is that in this particular custom, that is usually the custom that the oldest son would get his first. But the youngest boy comes to his father and says, "Give me my portion." And the text says that the daddy gave it to him. Y'all follow me? Bible says in the text that not long after that, he finds himself making a journey to a far country. Isn't it strange that when you get a pocket full of money, it seems like you can't sit still? If you don't believe money will burn your pocket, put enough of it in mine, and you'll find some stuff to spend it on. Y'all ain't never got no income tax. You didn't know how much stuff you need till you found out how much you was gonna get back on your return. So we find that somehow, here this boy, because when he gets his portion, he don't hang around home long. He makes a journey. But the Bible don't tell us how far he went. The Bible don't tell us how long he stayed. But it said it was a far country. And somebody in the house tonight may be in a far country. Some a little further than others, but I came to tell you, Jesus, I don't care how far you out, Jesus can bring you back. And the Bible says in the text tonight that when he went to a far country, it lets us know in the story that he wasted his substance on riotous living. In other words, everything that he got from his daddy, he wasted it. He wasn't down there having no prayer meeting. He wasn't down there going to church every Sunday. You know, y'all say what you want to. There's a point in time in your life where you can't wait to get out of mom and daddy's house. I can remember when I was growing up. Listen, y'all, do I have some help in the house? Don't you remember when you said, man, I'm tired of washing clothes. I'm tired of folding clothes. I'm tired of picking peas. I'm tired of doing all of this stuff. And I'm waiting on the day when I can leave where I am and go and have my own place. And I tell my children, they don't believe it. My daddy used to wake us up early in the morning when school was out, because we had to go and pick some stuff. And we had to go out and talk, because that's what he did. And somebody in the house needs to understand that there was a time where you thought life was better. As soon as I can get out of here, I'm tired of washing dishes. Now you discover that if you're washing dishes, you got to pay for the water. You got to buy the dish. You had to buy the food that messed up the dish. And that's why y'all eat on paper plates. The Bible says in the text tonight that he wasted his substance. And everything he had, I'm finna be through in a minute. Everything he had was gone. And it seems like to me that maybe I'm wrong. It's take longer to make money than it do to spend. It seems like you can spend a whole lot in just a little time. If you don't believe it, go in the store and walk around in a circle. You'll find stuff you need. I find that dangerous because I'm getting to the age now that, listen, when my wife would tell me to go to the store, and if I don't write it down, I'll go in the store and forget what I went in there for. And I got to walk around the store to try to remember what she told me to get. And the next time she said, write it down, and then I go off and leave the list. And then she got smart on me. Listen, she said, I got a phone. She texted me the list on the phone. I didn't have to read the phone. But the text says is that in his living, he wasted all of his substance, and he found himself in want. Granddaddy told us that, but I didn't realize it at the time what it meant. Waste make want. Here he is, down, not to his last dime, no dime, and he finds, listen, I tell you something. One thing about him, he had to be raised right, because he didn't go rob a bank. He didn't go rob the old lady's purse. The text says he connected himself with a citizen of that country and found a job feeding hard. And here this boy is, who never had to ultimately feed anything, finds himself in this specific position, feeding hogs something believed to be beneath him. And here he is. And the text tells us that he gets so hungry that even what the hogs eat start to look good to him. Anybody ever feed some hog? Don't act like y'all been in the city all your life. I know I ain't the only one in the house that done fed some hogs before. Are y'all listening to me? Everybody in the house know if you feed some hogs, hogs eat anything you put in that truck. Come on and help me tonight. I told somebody the other day, I said, my grandmama used to wash dishes in a dishpan. And when she got through with the water in the dishpan, if you pour it in there, the hog will drink the water with the soap in it. Somebody help me tonight. It don't matter what you put in there. And I told him, I said, look, you can get in there. If you lay still long enough, he'll eat you too. So here he is. Feeder, somebody said it. I hear you back there talking. If a snake crawled through the hog pen, he better hear him get out, because the hog would kill him. And y'all, come on, somebody. And y'all acting like y'all don't know nothing about it. Here this boy is. at the hog pen and the slop that the hogs eat start looking good to me. And when you get too far away from home, even the baddest stuff start looking good to you. Bible says in the text that he finds himself in what I like to term tonight as a hog pen experience. And I don't know about you, but I've been there. Somebody in the house done had a hog pen experience. When you know you're not where you're supposed to be, and you come to a point where you gotta try to figure out how to get back where you need to be. Somebody know about that tonight. Well, here this boy is. And as he sits at the pen, watching the hog, he says to himself, he says, now, the servants at my father's house got bread enough to spare. And here I am, starving to death. And the text says is that as he's thinking, sitting there at the hog pen, when he starts to come across how to get back to, he had to see some things. And when you get to a hog pen experience, it'll show you some stuff. And the first thing he saw tonight, he saw himself. See, when you get knocked down low enough, it forces you to look in the mirror. And here this boy tonight, he looked in the mirror and he did not like what he saw. He was dissatisfied with his current condition. And listen, you will never come back to God if you never get dissatisfied with your current condition. As long as you look in the mirror and say, I'm all right, you're not going to do anything to change what you look like. Amen. Y'all come on and help me tonight. Amen. Every last one of us, before we left out the house, we looked in the mirror. Amen. Some of us looked in it after we got to the church. Amen. And if it was something out of place, we tried to put it back in place. Amen. And if you really tell the truth, if you look in the mirror long enough, you're going to find some stuff in there you just don't like. Amen. No, I like everything about me. Well, just keep standing there. Let that perm grow out your hair. Y'all come on and help me. You, I don't like the way it looks. You're going to get it fixed because you want it to look better. Are y'all listening to me? Amen. You look in the mirror and maybe you don't look the same way you look when you finish school. I came to tell you tonight, when I look in the mirror sometimes, I don't look like I used to look. Sometimes my mind want to go back to where I was, but I'm not there right now. I'm standing right here. And I tell them sometimes, I said in my closet, I got a section. I got a want-to section. That's the clothes I want to get back into one day. I don't know about y'all, but I didn't get all them suits away. I got some hope that one day I'm going to get back in them, and I just let them hang there. Somebody ought to be wearing them, but I'm just got them in my closet. Y'all act like y'all don't know anything about that. It's some dresses there. You can't fit them. You just hope one day. Bible says in the text that here this boy is and he becomes dissatisfied with how he is. Now, as long as you cool and collected, you don't need to get no closer to Jesus in your mind. You ever seen folks come to church, don't nothing bother them? They just sit there with their leg crossed and they get so comfortable they go to sleep. Ain't talking about y'all now. That if you look in the mirror, everything all right. But somewhere down the line, and here this boy who hit rock bottom, and rock bottom means you can't get no more bottom. It ain't no more bottom in it. It's rock bottom, and when you get to the point where you can't go nowhere else, then you have to look at some alternative. He saw himself, and too many people decline to take a good look at themselves. Because when we look at ourselves, you really don't like a lot of the stuff that you see. Just because you don't look in the mirror don't mean it ain't there. So the text says he saw himself. But not only that, secondly, he saw his sin. What do you mean, preacher? The hog pen forced him to acknowledge his sin. He's sitting there. And he starts to remember the reason he's out there in the first place. He's out there because, listen, anytime you have to understand that when it comes to sin, sin is designed to separate us from the Father. And if you are separated from God, it ain't because God pulled a number on you. It's because of what we did. I tell them sometimes that there was a man and a lady who had been married 40 years. And they was riding down the road in the car, and the man was up under the wheel, the lady was way over at the door. Whole lot of room in between them. You know? The reason she wasn't no further away, because the door wasn't no further away. Her mind started to go back and think about how they used to ride. Y'all remember how we used to ride? You were driving with one. Ain't no one did it. Yeah, I remember Sister Ride used to scoot all the way over. They had in the car back then, they called a beach seat. Y'all act like y'all don't know nothing. Here we find that the man was driving. The lady started to remember. She said, "Don't you remember when we used to sit so close together? Don't you remember?" She looked at him and said, "Why are we so far apart now?" And the man, you heard it before. The man who's driving, he ain't even turned around. He said, "Listen, I'm sitting in the same place I was 40 years ago. You the one moved." What are you trying to say, preacher? If you wake up in the morning and listen, God is way over there and you way over here. Listen, God didn't move, you moved. The hog pen forced him to acknowledge his sin. Are y'all listening to me? And when you look at your sin, you discover that there's nothing else that you can do but repent. That's why it says it in your thing. Repent. You can't return before you repent. Because repent means I turn around and go back to where I started. I heard Monterey Daly say the other day that when you're on the football field and the man is running down the sideline and he steps out of bounds and the referee blows the whistle, he can run on to the end zone and dance all he wanna, but the referee throw the flag and say, "No, it don't count, you gotta come back to where you stand." And too many church folks in the end zone dancing. And you stepped out of bounds about 6 years ago, and you need to go back to where you stepped out, because the victory you're trying to claim don't count. He saw his sin. Are y'all listening to me? And anytime you see it, it's supposed to look ugly. Now, you don't have to raise your hand tonight, because I'm about finished in about 3 minutes. But look, have you ever just thought back in your life and just saw some of the stuff? And then when you finally seen it in the right light, just how bad it looked. And the more you looked at it, the worse you felt. And the more you looked at it, the more shame you felt. I know I'm in the house. And the more you looked at it, the more you wonder, why in the world did the Lord let me live? Yes, sir. You ever looked at some stuff and you look back and say, how was I so crazy? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Come on, right? Come on.
Right, my Lord.
If you have, you in good company. Because most of the folks in here done did it. They just ain't saying nothing to me. Listen, we hollered and slobbered last night. I know what you're looking for, but we go. I'm trying to. I'm fishing tonight. And the text said that here this man is in the hog pen, looking at himself, looking at his sin. And the text says that when he said he came to himself. Comes a point in time in all our lives, You got to come to yourself. It comes a point in time in all of our lives where it's time to grow up. Comes a point in time in all of our lives where we got to take responsibility. We got to take accountability. Mama can't get you out no more. Daddy can't get you out no more. Quit walking around like you spoiled and everybody owe you something. It comes to a point in time in our life, you got to come to yourself. And when he came to himself and started to examine himself and saw he was better off at home than he was in the hog pen. I was better off with my father than I was by myself. And somebody in the house need to understand tonight, you better off with God than you are without him. I wish y'all would hear me tonight. In life without God is not designed to be pretty. You cannot step away from God and take him out of your life and take him out of and take yourself out of the church and act like everything gonna be the same, cause it won't. You may fly high for a while, but it's just like an airplane run out of gas. You gonna stay up there for a little while, but you're going to come down eventually. And usually when you come down, it's a hard land. He saw himself. He saw his sin. But lastly, tonight, as he sits in this lowest position, he sees salvation. What does salvation mean? Salvation is freedom from where I am. He realized that he did not have to stay in the same place he was. Well, what do you mean, preacher? Can I say it like this? Every hog pen got a gate on me. And if you got in, you can get back out. Bible said in the text, he said, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to arrive and go back home to my father. Tell him that I've sinned against heaven and before thee. And when I go back, I'm not looking to be a son. I'm just looking to be a servant. When I get back, I'm not looking to get my old room back. I just want to be a servant. And when you go down and go to the old folks at the Sorrow Valley, when you go down to rock bottom, when you get back, you ain't trying to be Miss Cute. You ain't trying to be Mr. Big Stuff. All I want to be is a son. You ain't trying to lead every solo. You ain't trying to get up in front of folks. All you want, Lord, I just want to be in your presence. He realized tonight, I don't have to stay like I am. He says, I've got a father. And he's waiting on me. And here, this boy starts to make the long journey back home. Usually, the journey back home is longer than the journey away from home. But in my mind, I see him rehearsing every step of the way. The speech that he's going to tell his daddy, because he just hope his daddy let him back in. And somebody out there tonight is just hoping that the Father will let you back in. The Bible says that when he finally gets back home, that as he makes his way up the drive, that the Father sees him. See, in my mind, I really believe that the Father had some hope for his son. But I want to let you know in the text tonight that And the lost sheep, that the shepherd looks for the sheep, and the lost coin, the lady looks for the coin, but with the lost son, he got to come back on his own. Bob says in the text tonight, I really believe that the father periodically went out the front door looking and hoping that his son would come back home. And one day he sees a figure coming down the street. It don't look exactly like he looked when he left, but it is something about his walk. He walked just like my son. He don't look like he looked when he left. He had on good clothes. Now his clothes is all raggedy. When he left, he had on good shoes. But now the soles are all worn out. When he left home, he had a good haircut. Now his haircut is all grown over. But he may not look like he used to look. But I promise you, it ain't about what's on the outside. It's about what's on the inside. Somebody in the house tonight, maybe you don't look the same as you looked when you left. But God is not, he's not in so much looking at the outside, but God is looking at what's on the inside. And the father sees his son, and when he recognizes that that's his son, the text tells us that the father did something unusual, because the son usually has to make it to the father, but the father runs off the steps, runs down to the son, wraps his arms around the son, and as the son starts to tell his daddy, "Father, I'm sorry," the father, so look, don't listen to him, he says, "Somebody, go get a robe and put it on his back. Go get a ring and put on his finger. Get some shoes and put on his feet. For that my son that was dead, he's now alive. He's lost and now he's found. Matter of fact, kill the fatty calf. We gonna have a good time because I've been waiting on him. Ain't the Lord's my life." I want to let you know tonight that the Father, he's waiting on you. The Father wants you to come back home. I got a God that's got all power in heaven and earth in his hands. He's got so much power. He just didn't come for sin. He died for my sins. Ain't the Lord's all right? He didn't make a man. He became a man and came down to 42 generations. He lived 33 years. He died a sinner's death. He hung 3 hours in the day and 3 hours in the dark. He died until the sun went on strike. He died till the moon had an aneurysm and bled all over itself. He died till the stars lost their grip and fell out the silvery sockets. He died till the earth reeled and rocked like a drunk man. Ain't he all right? His blood was shed for my sin. No wonder grandmama said, "What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus." Is anybody here? Have you ever been washed? Isn't anybody here ever been clean? Ain't he all right? Do you know he's all right? He died, but I'm so glad that early light on Sunday morning, he got up with all power. Do you know him? Have you tried him? Ain't he all right? Shake your neighbor's hand. Say, "Neighbor, I done tried him. I done tried him. And I know he's all right." If you know he's all right, say, "Yeah, I got home on my mind. The text tells us that when the boy got home, said the daddy, "Who's the wrong woman?" I see in the text, he didn't tell him to take no bath. the room. The daddy didn't put the robe on him because he was clean. He put the robe on him to cover up the dirt that was down. What are you trying to say? Jesus, the Father don't accept me back because I'm clean. Well, I come back when I get my life together. You can't get it together. He don't accept you back because you're clean. But when you get back, he'll put something on you. It don't just cover your sin. It wash your sins away. Ajax can't do it. Tide can't wash it off. I'm trying to close. Joy dishwashing liquid. Y'all gotta help me tonight. When I was growing up, we didn't have no bubble bath. But if you wanted some bubbles, you put some dish soap in the water. You think Joy won't wash this off? But I came to tell you, it's the blood. Does anybody know about the blood? The blood don't sign my name. The blood don't sign my name. I didn't do no writing, but my name been signed. Ain't the Lord all right? Do you know him? Somebody in the house tonight, I'm through. You need to come back home tonight. Don't sit there and act like everything all right. Because it's not. But the Father is waiting for you to come back home. Somebody in the house tonight, maybe you never been baptized. You've never confessed. You need to come tonight. Somebody in the house, you know that your life is not going in the direction that the Lord wanted to go. Let's quit fronting. With the young folk, quit fronting. Quit acting like, no, you're trying to put on a good show. But you messed up on the inside. You need to rededicate your life. Can't nobody fix you like Jesus. I think the song said, can't nobody do me like you. Somebody in the house tonight needs to get in right. And somebody in the church, you ain't even speaking to them. I don't know. Nobody telling me nothing but God. I don't know who it is. But you know if you died tonight, you might not make it to heaven. You need to come tonight. Don't let pride keep you out of heaven. It's too, and listen, you ain't got to be young. It's some old folks need to come back. Well, they're going to talk about me. They're going to talk about you if you don't do that. Quit trying to worry about folks. Because the same folks that's going to talk about you need to come right up here with you. The church will not get better. I mean unity. If we don't all unify ourselves with Christ. We can pick on what's wrong with the church and pick on what's wrong with the preacher, pick on what's wrong with this and that, but unless you got Jesus, it ain't gonna do you no good. And we spend so much time talking about what's wrong with the church. How much do we talk about what's right with it? It's got to be something right with it because you here. If you in the house tonight, you need to come and make a commitment and rededicate your life to Jesus Christ. I don't care how long you've been out there, 20 days or 20 years, the blood can fix it. If you're in the house tonight, if the pastor comes and gives the official invitation, make your way up that aisle and make Jesus your choice, because I promise you, it's the best decision you could ever make. I came up the aisle, Holly Grove Baptist Church. Some of y'all done heard it in play. Dr. W.J. Spall. Y'all done heard of him? He was preaching. Gave Loyal Morgan my hand. Gave God my heart. Young fella. Didn't know a whole lot about it. But I promise you, when I got grown, a day showed up. And something happened to me. And I felt something. I didn't mean to say all of this. But I went to get in my car at home to crank it, and the car wouldn't start. And I went back outside because I wanted to figure out what was wrong with it. And when I got outside by myself, I tried to crank it and it started. And the Lord had me outside by myself. And something started moving on me. Tears started running down. And all I can do is say, I know he's been good to me. Something got a hold of me. And if you're in the house tonight and you know him for yourself, he can get a hold of you too. Make your life right with Christ. Repent. Return. Be restored. Because you cannot have restoration without returning. And you can't return without repenting. And if you're in the house tonight, you need to come. While the pastor come, while the choir sing, the remainder of the service is in his hand, but you need to come tonight. Forgive me, pastor, but I'm still fishing. If somebody in this house need to get it right. Usually it's the ones that's looking up at me frowning. Oh, all y'all want to smile at me. You don't have to, listen. You don't have to come to give your long list of stuff. We don't want to hear all of that. You just need to say, I need Jesus to restore my life. And I promise you, he can do it. How many of y'all know he can do it?
God all some praise, amen. The doors of the church are open. The doors of the church are open. We're gonna come down and receive you right now. You got home on your mind. You ought to come. This may be your last chance. Reverend said you don't have to worry about getting clean. Come like you are. Amen. Will there be one? We're standing here to receive you right now. Give me your hand and God your heart. Will there be one? Will there be one? The doors are open. At this moment,